affects the way that they go through life. So people who are in marginalized groups live life a little bit differently than some other people do. They kind of live in the same world, but completely different. So intersectionality is where all of these things meet. The way that a white man goes through life is very different than the way a person of color who's a man goes through life. And all of these things stack on top of each other and kind of, like I said, form this pancaking effect. So in the United States, women earn 80.9% of what men make. And that actually sounds like a really great number, but this is down from 82.5% just 2 years ago. So we have on a very large scale, and I'm sorry, a lot of this talk is very American-centric just because that's the statistics that are readily available to me, but this is also very applicable to other countries as well. So women are one group, and they earn a lot less than men do. So this is controlling for all other factors, including education, time in and away from the industry, any kind of other experience that might affect their ability to do their job. So that's kind of terrible, but this is worse. So this is that intersectional effect. You have women on the whole that are making 80% of what men are making, but Latina women are only making 59.3%. So the stacking on effect of those two things creates a greater problem for somebody who's in a different group. Likewise, the unemployment rate in the United States is about 7.5%, depending on where you get your statistics and who you want to trust. But the unemployment rate for the blind is much higher. This has to do with a lot of things. It has to do with education, has to do with access to quality education, has to do with the way that people in the blind community are perceived, the way that they're taught, for instance. A lot of our society is very sight-centric. So kind of, there's a lot of definitions in here. So if you need me to stop or go back, just let me know. So privilege. I'm sure a lot of people have heard this before, and it's something that kind of gets a bad rap. Privilege isn't necessarily a bad thing to have. It just means that you're born with like a special set of traits when you're born. So if you're white, if you're male, if you're straight, those are all kind of what society considers normal, default. You get like some kind of bonus things for that. It doesn't make you a bad person because you have privilege, but it does mean that you have to take a little bit of extra time and educate yourself about the way that people that are different than you go through life. Because when you have privilege, it's really hard to see, and it's really hard to tell when other people are experiencing something different than you. So the different kinds of privilege, people in a default group, and for this exercise, we'll just focus on white men, because they're very dominant in our industry, tend to have access to better education, technology at a much earlier age. They tend to get higher paid, which we mentioned before. Automatically assumed competent. That is one that's really close to me. I speak at a lot of conferences. I just spoke at a conference about a month ago, and I got up on stage and said, I'm a developer, I've been doing this for 12 years, I really love what I do, and talked for an hour about all the things that I do and the things that I love. And this is a single-track conference. Everybody's in the exact same room. And at the after party, three people came up to me and asked if I was a project manager. Now, they didn't mean anything by it. They weren't trying to say, I don't think you're competent. But because there are so few women in our industry, and there are so few technical women in our industry, this is kind of something that their brain automatically is like a shortcut, automatically wires to, you are a woman here, you're probably in marketing, you're probably in project management, maybe you're a designer. I just spoke with somebody from an agency a week ago that said that she's an intern developer, and everybody keeps saying that she's an intern designer inside her company, which is like 10 people. So people just, it's hard to see, and it's hard to realize when you're doing it. Quality of social and professional network. We tend to kind of stay in the same class our entire lives. It's an unfortunate part of our society where we're born into a class. It's very, very hard to escape because of things like our education, the amount of money that we have, the amount of money that our parents have. That influences the quality of education we can have, and therefore the quality of professors we get at universities, the quality of jobs that we get. It basically affects your entire life. Seen as a skill set instead of traits. So you're a developer instead of a black developer. It's a very big difference. you're a developer, you don't need that extra label. You see the same thing with geek girls. We're not just geeks, we're geek girls. So we're set apart as something that's different than the default. And the last one, easily fit into and identify with the subculture. So in our culture, in Drupal, for instance, we have a very big geek culture. We assume that people like to play video games, that they like to program until 3 o'clock in the morning, that they generally live alone, or that they don't have partners, or they don't have children. We assume that they're male. All of these things kind of work into that culture. And a lot of people are able to easily assimilate into this because they fall into that group. But people that fall outside of that have a much harder time. So if you have a woman that has children who is not able to go to hackathons and stay up until 2 o'clock in the morning because she has to go home and take care of her children, she is set aside from that culture. She's not able to participate in that aspect of culture. If you have people that have an aversion to alcohol, they don't like being in places where alcohol is served, or they don't like being in loud places, going to a conference like this where there will be a lot of after parties that are in dark, loud places where a lot of people are drinking, that's a very different atmosphere than some people are used to being in, and it makes them uncomfortable. So the next one we have is stereotype threat. Most people know what a stereotype is. We generally associate this with something that's negative, unless in our brains we allow ourselves to make assumptions about people because it's easier, like I said, that little shortcut. So stereotype threat basically says somebody believes there's something about me as a person, some trait that I have, that's negative, and I'm more likely to exhibit that trait because I'm worried that I'm going to exhibit that trait, which is very difficult to think about, right? So if you think about, there's been a lot of research done where high school students are primed going into a special test, and they'll say to the students, one group of students will say, did you know that men tend to do better on this test? Men tend to be better at math. And they say to the other group, you know, it's actually incorrect that men are better at math. Women and men do about the same when it comes to math. The latter group does far better than the former group, because the former group in their head is saying, I expect myself not to do as well as a man, because women aren't as good at math as men are. So it kind of creates this negative reinforcement within themselves. And then, unfortunately, because they're exhibiting that, then they're upholding the stereotype and they're seen as this entire group. I'm sure a lot of people have seen this one before. So, the default people, men, are you know, one person, my second math, but a girl, a woman representing this stereotype, this negative stereotype, now represents her entire group. It's not just you that are bad at math, it's your entire group that is bad at math. So we're, by basically accidentally exemplifying this trait, we're representing our entire group. And think about what that means when, you know, when somebody goes to speak at a conference or is on a new team for a site that's about to launch and it's very visible and they make a mistake. And they're the only person that exhibits that trait on their team. Wow, girls are bad at programming. You know, we have the Barbie meme of, you know, technology is hard, let's go shopping. You know, that's something that's, you know, it's not said about men, but it's very specifically about women. The next one is imposter syndrome. I know a lot of people feel this in themselves, and this is actually something that's felt by everybody. It's not specific to a certain group, but unfortunately, it's kind of amplified when you're somebody that's different. So you feel that you have this negative stereotype, and people are going to see you as that kind of person. So that makes you less likely to apply for jobs, especially in groups where competency has to be proven more. So we talked about women before. Women have to prove themselves a lot more. People of color have to prove themselves a lot more. People with visible physical disabilities have to prove themselves a lot more. I spoke with somebody during the process of a bunch of interviews that I did who was physically handicapped. She walked with a cane because she had hip cancer, and she had it removed, and she had to walk with a cane for the rest of her life. And she was a security consultant, and she would go into companies and have to go and, you know, if you think of, like, the traditional big company where they have a lot of desktop machines, had to go and like pick up a machine, install some software, or fix something on it in a different office and then bring it back. So she's been doing this job for about 10 or 12 years. And after she has her surgery, she goes on an interview. And her interviewer says, "How can you expect to do this job if you walk with a cane?" And I mean, like, she's telling me this, and I'm like, in my brain, I'm freaking out. And she says, "I was kind of stunned," and I said, "What do you mean? How do you know? I still have, you know, full mobility. Otherwise, I just have to walk with a cane." And the interviewer said, "Well, how can you go and pick up computers and bring them back to our office to work on them?" And she said, "Well, don't you use a cart? Like, it's pretty standard practice because computers are heavy and they're dusty and dirty, that you would put a computer on a cart and then push the cart to wherever it has to go. Like, we invented the wheel a long time ago. This is not a difficult concept." So the guy says, "Well, how can you push a cart if you're walking with a cane?" And she said, "Well, I would put the cane on the cart and then push the cart." And like, this hadn't even occurred to him. It's something that was completely beyond him, that she would be able to push a cart while still having a cane. And this is illegal. In the United States, this is very illegal. But unfortunately, it's extremely difficult to prove, especially if you're in a one-on-one interview, especially if all of the people that are in the room are only representatives of that company. It's very difficult to prove. So a lot of things like this, where we talk about discrimination lawsuits, you know, why didn't so-and-so sue if that's the kind of treatment that they get? It's very difficult to prove. It's very long, arduous process. And if you're in a group that's marginalized, that tends to make a lot less money, that tends to have far fewer options, how can you afford a lawyer? How can you afford to take time off of work to go to court? All of these things kind of compound on each other. So they're also less likely to submit a talk to conferences. So when we talk about being an imposter, think about feeling like you don't know as much as everybody else. And I know that there are people in this room that would say, "I would never speak at DrupalCon," or "I would never speak at Drupal Camp," because I don't know enough. I'm not as smart as other people. Everybody already knows all the things that I know. This is something that people with imposter syndrome face all the time. And I've met perfectly brilliant people that have done amazing things in this community that would never step up on stage because they're so worried that somebody is going to say, "That's not right. What you just said is wrong," you know, and call them out for being a phony or call them out for not knowing as much as they thought they knew. They're also less likely to attend a conference. So that's a difficult one. As a woman and as somebody who's been in this industry for about 12 years, I have been the only woman at a conference. I have been the only queer person at a conference. And it's a very weird feeling to, especially if it's a group that you're not familiar with. Like, I went to a conference recently where I was the only woman that I could see, and there's probably, I don't know, 80 or 100 guys in this, like, large room. And I went to go walk through to, like, go and grab some water, and it was like the seas parted. They were like, "Here comes a woman. Everybody move aside." And I'm like, that is very awkward. Like, to be basically pointed out that you're other, that you're different, it's a very difficult situation to be in. It's very uncomfortable. I've heard people compare this to, imagine being in a knitting group, which tend to be heavily dominated by women, and being the only man. It's kind of a weird thing, right? It makes you feel a little bit uncomfortable. So I've talked about marginalization a couple times. And marginalization is basically you have one dominant group that pushes another one aside because their needs and desires are not the same as their own. So think about working at a place as, I hate to keep using the example of women, but working at a place as a woman, and you have a business meeting, and the men decide that they're going to go to a strip club for the meeting. This is an example that has actually happened many, many times. And to me, that seems obvious. Like, number one, it doesn't seem like a very professional place to take a client, but, you know, maybe I'm in the minority there. But as a woman, that's a very different atmosphere to be in than a man. Unfortunately, society teaches all of us to do this. It teaches women to do it about other women. It teaches people of color to do it about other people of color. People with disabilities against other people with disabilities. None of us are immune to this. And I've had a lot of people say to me, specifically in the technology community, "But I'm different. I'm unfortunately, like, even the people that are who are at the top of the logic and rationalization game do it to each other. Scientists do it to each other. STEM professors do it to each other. There was an experiment that was done at Yale where they took a bunch of professors there, and these are very distinguished professors from all different kinds of departments in STEM, and said, here are two resumes. This is a person that's applying for a laboratory manager job. On a scale of 1 to 7, how likely are you to give each one of these people this job? They had identical resumes for John and for Jennifer. Across the board, men and women, John was given a 4 on that scale. Jennifer was given a 3.3. The exact same resume, exact same wording. The only difference was the first name. The only difference. When they asked how much they would pay them each for that job, Jennifer was paid 87% less. This is at Yale University. Very intelligent people. People who know that these kinds of biases and discrimination exist. And they still did it. Marginalization happens also within our group, so even female scientists were doing this to Jennifer, the fictional Jennifer. So we're all kind of raised in this society that says that some people are less competent, some people have less education, some people are lazier, some people won't be good for this job because they're not biologically predisposed to being logical, they're too emotional. I'm sure that everybody has heard these kinds of things before. So all of us has this in us, and it's that bias that we have to educate ourselves about so we can start combating it. So how diverse is the tech industry? For the purpose of this, just because it's a little bit easier to get statistics globally, I'm going to use gender. Specifically, unfortunately, it's binary gender, so it's just women represented in this. So women make up 24% of the industry. That's kind of crappy when we make up like 52% of the world population. Every other STEM field, we make between 48% of those industries. In some places, like physical sciences, biology, we're actually doing better than them. But depending on who you ask, 1.5 to 3% of us actually contribute to open source. So how many women contribute to Drupal? Does anybody know? We actually have no idea. So we know that 17% of DrupalCon attendees are female, who identify themselves as female. But outside of that, we don't know. And actually, that statistic is directly tied to the t-shirt shape that they choose, which makes it a little bit problematic. So there are a lot of women that take men's shaped shirts. There are a lot of men that take women's shaped shirts. There are people that don't take any t-shirt. So unfortunately, we just don't know. We have no idea. It's nice that we have some very high up women that are in the community, obviously. It's awesome having Angie as kind of like the beacon of somebody to look up to who is in our group and who represents a very large, diverse group of us that aren't otherwise represented. So this is tech industry versus the U.S. population. The dark gray is the tech industry. The light gray is the U.S. population. Some of these you might see are a little bit off. So there are some groups that are way more represented than others, and others that are barely represented at all. And unfortunately, these numbers are actually going down. They're not getting better. We have far fewer women, far fewer people of color, that are completing computer science degrees at every level. We have, no matter the level of education attainment, women and people of color are less likely to be employed than white men. So even at the PhD level, women and people of color are less likely to be employed. So lack of diversity is really a global problem. I've been talking a lot about the United States, just because that's where a lot of the statistics come from. But it's kind of all over the place. So we have India has about 8% women in computer science. The U.S. has 17%. This is a number that is going down, like I said before. The United Kingdom, 18.2%. France, 20%. Brazil, Africa 25. So what's the problem with these numbers? If this is so across the board, what does this tell us about women in computer science? Maybe women aren't interested in programming, which is funny because I see a lot of women in here. Maybe women aren't biologically predisposed to programming. Maybe they have something in their brain that just doesn't make them good at programming. It just makes us so much better at shopping. Actually, there is no difference. There's no physical or biological difference that impacts a person's ability to be a programmer. This is scientifically proven. This is backed up by the UN. And everything that we're seeing is purely social, which is great because that means that we can actually fix this. And one of the statistics I left out when I was going over those countries before is Bulgaria. This is like totally under the radar spy stuff going on here. Like, how are they getting three times more, sometimes 10 times more than some of these other countries? It's kind of amazing. Like, I can't say that I think much about Bulgaria. Like, I don't know how much time I've ever given to think about Bulgaria. I've never been there. I'm sure it's a lovely place. But why is Bulgaria doing so much better than everywhere else? Why, when we're talking about the most intelligent nations in the world and the most evolved nations in the world, are we not talking about Bulgaria? The thing that is not represented in the statistic is the fact that in Eastern Europe, it's much more likely that parents will push their children, regardless of gender, into a STEM field. Women actually graduate at a much higher rate in Bulgaria. They make up a much larger percentage of all of the STEM fields. This is actually the greatest one. This is the highest one. So if a country in Eastern Europe who has a much lower GDP than the United States, who we probably assume, you know, the stereotype that they have less money, they probably have less education. Why are they doing so much better at this than us? So now that we've kind of established that there is a problem in our industry, and I'm sure that many of you, having gone to conferences and having seen the people that are represented on stage, working in the industry and seeing the people that you're working with, you've noticed that there is a lack of diversity. So why does it matter? It really matters to businesses. It's kind of amazing what the difference of diversity makes. When racial and gender diversity increases, you get higher profits, you get a higher market share, you have a higher amount of money that you earn compared to your competitors. Diverse teams can solve problems faster and better. So why don't we have more diversity on our teams? Diverse groups are more creative, and diverse exposure to a team actually creates exponential effect. It gets better and better as the years go on. So we make better decisions. There's more innovation, which in our industry we need more than anywhere else. Science and technology are kind of at the forefront of everything that's going on in the world over the next 20 years. We need more innovation here, which means we need more diversity. Companies are losing out on the benefits of diversity every single day because they hire the same kind of people all the time because they're not giving different kinds of people a shot. So if you can make more money and if your team and your company can do better, why aren't we? Diversity also matters to society. In our society, we have a very obvious hierarchy. It's kind of dominated by class in the United States. There are a very rigid set of classes. Like I said before, people are less likely to escape their classes through their lives. When they're born into a class, they continue into that class. They're unlikely to make very much more money than their parents made. So by fixing these issues, we can start healing the problem of unequal pay, of lack of opportunity. We can have more people going to school. We can have greater than 20% of the grads at CS colleges being women. We can also create class mobility. So in STEM, we make a lot more money than everyone else. have seen that. I mean, how many people in here make more money and they know than their parents? Yeah. It's probably pretty shocking to your parents. Like, you're 22 and you're making more money than me. Yeah, it's pretty shocking. So in tech, women earn about 87% versus that 80.3% that I mentioned earlier. We make far more money over the course of our lifetimes. Anybody with a STEM degree, even if they're not in the STEM field, even if they don't continue, they tend to make more money. So we need to have more people that are graduating with STEM degrees, more people that are getting into technology, more people that are able to pull themselves and their families out of the classes that they have existed in for hundreds of years. Bless you. So why the lack of diversity? There are so many different reasons. I'm just going to go into a handful of them today, kind of rapid fire. So we have pipeline. Pipeline is bringing people into the industry. There are a lot of reasons for this. Cultural cues. We have the difference between what we give to small boy children, what we give to small girl children. Most notably the color for some reason, like no one's really sure why. But we also tend to give boys toys that are things that have to do with building, have to do with engineering, that have to do with games, with hand-eye coordination. We tend to give them computers. All of these things at a much earlier age. There are no famous role models that represent groups other than white straight men. There are so few. The ones that we talk about a lot, especially when it comes to women, are people that have been dead for 200 years. That's pretty bad. Like, it's awesome that like women invented the first programming language, the first compiler. We've done a lot of amazing things. But we've done stuff in the past 200 years, too, right? Also, access to technology. I was talking about computers earlier. On average, men get their first computer at a much earlier age than women. So think about how many times you've heard a friend say, I've been programming since I was 8. You know, my first thing was in BASIC, da-da-da-da-da. That's unlikely to be the experience of a woman. It's unlikely to be the experience of a person of color. African-American and Hispanic households have a much lower adoption rate, and it's much less quick than white households. But they adopt smartphones at a much faster pace. So think about what that means. Like, I use my smartphone all the time, and I love it, for the most part, except for when I try to do anything difficult. Right? I would not want to book a flight on a smartphone. Even simple sites. I mean, like, Facebook is one thing, but, like, when you go to actually, like, look at your healthcare profile and book an appointment with your doctor or try and figure out what your test results are, try and do that on your phone. So if you're a family that the only access to technology you have is at the public library, which are being defunded, which tend to have less internet connectivity, which tend to have old computers if they have any computers, your exposure to cutting-edge technology is a much less, much smaller rate. You tend to have to make a much bigger jump to get to modern technology. When, as an adult, it takes you a lot longer to get your first computer. So white people tend to get their first computers around 17, 18. People of color, it's mid-20s. It's a big difference. I mean, imagine if the first time that you got access to a computer was when you were 25. Some people in this room might not even be 25 yet. So it's also access to quality education. When you live in a poor neighborhood, your teachers aren't being paid as well. You don't have as great like computers and updated programs. And your high school education is one of the greatest indicators of what you're going to make in your life. So you have diminished experience. Schools in neighborhoods have schools in poor neighborhoods have lower quality math and science programs. There is a 25% difference between white people and people of color when it comes to the quality of science and math education that they're getting. And that directly affects how well they're going to do in college. Imagine going into college and not understanding a thing the professor is presenting in his 101 class. How does that make you feel? Stupid? I don't belong here. I'm not cut out for college. I can't do this. degree means you are more likely to stay in your class, means you're more likely to have children in poverty. Access to healthcare is a big one. We have less mobility, especially in the United States, because our healthcare is tied to our jobs. So when you have women being more likely to be caregivers of both children and adult dependents, and they can't leave their job, they can't relocate across the country, they can't take risks at the same rate that men can because they have other people relying on them for things like health insurance, you have less mobility. There are some groups that have very little or very poor access to health care. Some groups, especially transgender folks, have very poor access to health care. Many health care providers don't cover anything at all. So you can pay for health insurance and get none of the benefits of it. So think about what that means when you can't be your whole self without your medication. When you have issues that require you to have medication to be able to get through a day without a seizure. That's a big deal. I mean, thinking about going to work and having to worry about your health all day long. So the second area is attraction. It's much harder to attract diverse people to the field. We have lack of role models, like I was talking about earlier. We're less likely to see people that represent us in the field. We see Steve Jobs, we see Bill Gates, we see white, straight, older guys. Then we have people like Mark Zuckerberg. So we have white, straight, younger guys. Like, that is kind of the gamut of diversity that we have in the industry right now. We don't have people that look like us. We also have this geek stereotype. So, really quick, what are some stereotypes of geeks? Nobody knows any stereotypes of geeks? They don't speak up, sure. That's a great one. What's that? Yes. They're shy, they're awkward in social situations. What's that? Nocturnal, yes, great. So if you don't identify with any of those things, it turns you off. There are actually studies that have shown that women that are exposed to people that meet those stereotypes, even if they're not the majority in our industry, are half as likely to pursue CS degrees because they think they're not gonna fit in, because they think they're gonna be uncomfortable with this person that doesn't want to look them in the eyes, that doesn't want to talk to them. That's not the fault of a person that's socially awkward or a person that just can't deal with social situations. But if nobody looks like you, if nobody acts like you, that greatly impacts how likely you are to stay in the industry. So attrition. This is probably the hardest one for me to talk about. Like I said, I've been in the industry for 12 years, which is past my prime, according to the statistic. Which is really scary. This is twice the attrition rate of men. This, only 20% of that accounts for women having children. So we're still 2/3 more likely to leave the industry within 10 years. There are a lot of reasons for this. Harassment is a big one. A lot of people have experienced harassment. I've experienced a lot of harassment over the past 12 years. People in a marginalized group are less likely to speak up. People that are outside of a marginalized group are likely to say this. So how does this make me feel if I say I was just in an elevator and somebody grabbed my butt? Right? We have a code of conduct here. But if I go up to somebody and I say, I just had this horrific experience, it makes me not want to stay here anymore, I'm not comfortable, I'm afraid of seeing this person again. And somebody tells me, I've never seen that happen, like, you're totally blowing this out of proportion. This is something that happens very rarely. That makes me feel like what just happened to me, which might be very traumatic, it might actually lead to me leaving the industry, people don't really care about, because it's not something that they've seen. And if you're in a group that this kind of thing doesn't happen to, you know, where people aren't calling you racial slurs, you know, because you're a white person, which the vast majority of people in the industry are, and you say to a person of color that I've never seen somebody I've never heard somebody say a racial slur in our community. We're much better than that. How does it make them feel? So the next one is discrimination. And this is in a lot of different areas. Our pay, our advancement, job offers. A lot of people will say, well, women get paid so much less. Why don't they just ask for more money? It is scientifically proven that even when women ask for more money, they still get paid less. And now they're seen as bitches. there isn't any winning in this. This one is fun. So men are 2.7 times more likely to be in higher positions than women. This is controlling for education, controlling for experience, controlling for amount of time in the industry. Everything being equal, men are almost 3 times more likely to be in higher positions than women. So there are a lot of solutions because there are a lot of problems. The biggest one is the fact that change starts with us. I see that there are a lot of visible marginalized people in this room. So it's a little bit harder for us to speak out, but it's something that we need to help the people around us do as well. A lot of people aren't educated about this, and they just don't know. So we kind of have to deal with the ignorance for a little while, unfortunately. And education is a Trojan horse to empathy. When people start to meet the people that aren't like them, they start to care about those people. So if you have a female friend and you meet another woman at a conference and she says, "Someone just grabbed my butt in an elevator," you're a lot more likely to relate this person who you may not know at all to your female friend. Because I can't imagine that happening to my female friend. I can't imagine that happening to somebody else that I care about. And we also have to understand that discrimination bias are really subtle. Gone are the days when somebody would say, if you want a promotion, then you have to have sex with me. That is much less likely to occur than somebody saying, you're the only woman in the meeting, and they don't actually say you're the only woman in the meeting. Can you take notes? Can you go get us coffee real quick? And then all the business happens while you're going to get coffee. So it's a lot more subtle. We have to watch out for these things. And like I said, because of privilege, it's a lot harder to see that. We might not mean that, you know, we don't want you in the room or we think of you as a secretary, but this constant reminder that, oh, here's a woman. She must be a project manager. She must be in marketing. She must be a designer. Like, very specific roles that we allow certain people to be in. The other one is learning to apologize. Like, you're going to screw up. I screw up all the time. People call me out for it all the time, which I really appreciate. Sometimes it's in a painful way, which, I don't know why there's a laser on. Sometimes it's in a really painful way. It's very public. And sometimes it's in private, but that's not really up to me to decide. I was the one that made the mistake. It doesn't really matter how egregious it was. I'm the one at fault. So it's really hard to deal with, but learning to apologize, and I like to tell people it's super, super easy. It's like making ice cubes. Have you guys seen the recipe for making ice cubes online? Put the water in the thing, put it in the freezer, wait a couple hours, ice cubes. Super easy, like 3 steps. So apologizing is the exact same way. So apologies only have 3 steps, and if you go beyond 3 steps, you have to stop and start over. So the first one is what I did was wrong. So recognizing that you did something wrong versus saying, I don't really know why you're mad at me, but I'm sorry, so you should stop being mad. Or I'm not going to apologize because I don't know what I did wrong. Second one is just saying, I'm sorry. Simple as that. Do not say the word but, because then I will kick you in the butt. That is the way that it works. And then the third one is making up for what you just did by trying your hardest not to do it again. It's really important because you're going to come across a lot of situations where you'll probably be in the exact type of situation. And think of how disrespectful it is to just tell somebody over there, I'm sorry that I just did X, and then go over here and do the exact same thing. Like, you didn't learn your lesson. Like, I just went through that horrible thing calling you out for nothing. So advocating for change. This is something that everybody who has privilege has to do. This is our job as people with privilege. Because people who do not have this privilege are less likely to be heard by other people with privilege. This is the unfortunate side effect of privilege, right? So if I stand up and say, I just got assaulted in the elevator, this is a problem, we need a code of conduct, a lot of people are going to get really defensive about that. And it's happened a lot. Like, I talk to a lot of conference organizers about this. They get really defensive about it. I understand. But coming from a guy where they say, I've heard that people have been assaulted at this conference, and we need to do better. That's seen as a lot less, it makes them a lot less defensive, so it kind of puts them in an easier position where they feel like they can have that conversation without having to defend themselves or defend the actions of other people. So it's our job to stand up. We need to talk about these issues openly. This is really important. I'm sure that a lot of people have seen online a lot of terrible I would say that these incidents aren't happening more often, but we're kind of getting to this point where people are reporting them more often, where they're being brought into light more often. And it's great because it gives us the chance to stand up and be public about it and show people that we support them. And it also gives us an excellent opportunity to educate bystanders. Because a lot of people will never experience these kinds of things. Because of the makeup of our community, it's very unlikely that a lot of people that are in like this dominant privileged group are going to see the kinds of problems that people who aren't in that same group see. So it's important that we talk about these things so they can learn from the situation without committing these kinds of problems and having to go through this huge, terrible thing. And it's really easy to do. All you have to do is, like, I physically grab people. Like, I will, like, change the subject to, like, I don't really understand why that's funny. Or, like, can you explain to me why that's funny? Because I don't get it. Oh, I still don't get it. Maybe it's just not funny. Like, you think that's it? I don't think that's really funny. And it makes them uncomfortable enough to not make stupid jokes like that again. Or to not say the kinds of things that they were saying again. It's kind of like a frown of shame, right? So you're, like, subtly shaming people. So call people out. Don't let brilliant programmers get away with crap. We have so many problems in this industry where because people are in this position where they're very well respected, or because we really enjoy watching them speak, or we have their book, we're less likely to say something to them when they do one of these horrible things. And they are the first people we should be calling out because they are the role models for every other person in the community. Allowing that to slide says, that's totally okay, that guy did it, like, now I have an excuse to do it, because everybody's doing it, right? So influencing change starts within the community. It also starts within our workplaces. Talking to your boss, talking to your coworkers, talking to people at conferences about these kinds of issues and the really difficult conversations to have. And, like, I just had one yesterday and it was kind of painful. Some people are never going to get it, and I have to kind of deal with that. But even if I change one person's mind, or if I, like, if they ask me for resources so I can, you know, send them a book or send them a link so they can learn more, that is a win in my book. We also need to be increasing access to quality education. We do this in a number of ways. The nice thing about our community is we have fewer and fewer companies that are requiring CS degrees, which is really great because, as we saw before, very few women are graduating with them. Very few people of color are graduating with them. So we can help facilitate events, like educational events and programs for people that are in marginalized communities. There are great programs like Black Girls Code, which is represented all over the United States, that is for girls between 11 and 17, I want to say, where they're taught to program. There's things like Girl Develop It, which is for older teenage girls and young adults to learn how to program. Black entrepreneurs and Latino startups specifically help people of color do better, especially with VCs, because VCs are far more white and straight and male than the tech industry in general. So we need to be supporting these kinds of things and helping them. We can volunteer at local schools and groups, Girl Scouts, Boys and Girls Club. All of these programs are always looking for people to come in and teach new and fun things. The Girl Scouts actually just added a, like, computer programming badge, which is awesome. Like, I would have been a Girl Scout if that was the case when I was a kid. So we need to be focusing on groups that don't have the traditional kind of access. Don't go into, like, Richie McRich's neighborhood and be giving them computers and money because they don't need it, truthfully. Commit financial resources. So if you are giving money to the college or university you went to that predominantly puts out people that look very much like the rest of the people in this industry, divide that in half and give it to a college that focuses on women or focuses on people that have come from a lower class. Give it to community colleges. Give it to scholarship programs. Give it to the people who actually need the help. Work with colleges and universities, especially if you're a business. A lot of them actually want input because they want to see their grads get hired. So say things like, what are you doing to help students that have less access to technology? It might be that they've never thought about that before. We can start removing bias from schools and universities. There's a school called Harvey Mudd that doubled the number of female CS grads. you ever programmed before? Then they took the people who hadn't programmed before and put them in a separate, like, 101 class. Because they didn't go into that class saying, these people have been programming forever, I don't get it, I'm dumb. We can change our workplaces. Think about what the about page for your website, your business website, looks like. Is it all white guys? Have you guys seen the 100% men Tumblr? It's basically screenshots of a bunch of businesses where it's like, white dudes, all right, white dudes, sweet, like every single one of them. And the vast majority of businesses look like that. We can't expect to attract diverse communities if all of the higher-ups in our businesses are just all straight white dudes. Be vocally supportive of these things. Go out of your way, go into the community, create diversity statements at conferences, at your workplace, attend events and job fairs that specifically reach out to communities that are different than yours. Make sure that the language and requirements in your job listings don't say he, this guy. There's actually another Tumblr called Tech Companies Who Only Hire Men. Exact same thing. It's all like every single pronoun is male. Every single noun is this guy or this man. Requiring a CS degree is another big one we talked about earlier. Making sure that benefits actually benefits the people that you want to hire. Making sure that you have same-sex partner benefits, that you have trans-inclusive healthcare, which is a huge one right now. Making sure that you have adequate maternity leave policies and that you have flex time for people who have to care for dependents or that have to go to a lot of medical appointments. Interviewing, making sure that your interview process actually looks like what it'll be like to work in your job. Are they going to have access to Google? Then give them access to Google in the interview. Are you only going to require that they have 15 minutes to write an algorithm? Then don't require that they have 15 minutes to write an algorithm. Make it feel like they would work there. Actually paying people the same. This one seems pretty obvious, but we don't do it. It is illegal to pay people differently based on their gender or based on their race. So do a payroll audit. Make sure that people are being paid similarly. Don't only give out raises when people ask for them, because women and people of color are much less likely to ask for them. What's the time? Cool. So culture. Making sure that you're changing your culture internally before you enact all of these things, because it is a lot harder to keep diversity than it is to recruit it. There's nothing worse than having somebody move across the country to work at your company, only to find out that they're going to work with a bunch of very immature people that don't respect work-life balance, that maybe the only things that they do are drink, and you're very uncomfortable with that. You need to make sure that your environment is ready for people that are going to be different than you. Making sure that the people you're bringing in, you're mentoring, putting them on a career path goal so they know what they want to do and you help them achieve that. Improve inclusion at conferences. This is one I work on a lot, and this is one that, especially in our community where a lot of people are running things like camps or they're running meetups, can start doing. Your organizing team should be as diverse as the people that you want to see in your audience. This one seems pretty obvious to me, but it's kind of lacking to a lot of other people. If you want to attract women, maybe get a woman's perspective. If you live in an area that's predominantly Hispanic and your entire meetup or your entire conference is white people, there's probably a problem there. Work with the community, include a diverse set of ideas and opinions in every process that you do, and ask the community what they need. Maybe they need discounted tickets. Maybe, you know, they need access to childcare. You don't know until you ask them. Get a code of conduct. I think this is the first or second DrupalCon where we have a code of conduct, which is excellent. Really excited about that. It doesn't necessarily prevent things, but it allows people to know that if they do have an issue, that they're going to be listened to. And that's a really big deal. If you know that you're going to go out of your way to report, and you face a lot of problems reporting in and of itself, you want to know that that person's going to believe you and that they're going to help you. Offer scholarships, like I said, help financial assistance. When you're making a lot less money, things cost a lot more to you. So if I'm being paid 20% less, I'm hoping that going to your conference would cost me 20% less than other people. Help people out. Anonymize proposals. That way you're not unintentionally discriminating against people. Like I said, even scientists do this to each other. Even female scientists do this to other female scientists. Start doing outreach. Reach out to groups and communities in your area that are specifically working with communities that you don't see right now. Reach out to women's groups. Reach out to LGBTQ resource centers. A lot of them have cool programs that allow people to learn more. silver bullet. I listed 100 different things here. None of these is going to fix the problem. There is no easy fix. It's going to be a very long road. It's a multifaceted problem. It requires a lot of different solutions. And the biggest thing is it requires participation from all of us. Does anybody have any questions in the last couple minutes? Otherwise, I'll be here for the rest of the conference, so feel free to ask. Okay? So, thank you very much. Thanks for getting up early on the first day of DrupalCon. You can leave feedback, and also there are resources available on my website. I'm also very willing to speak with conference organizers, with business owners, with community organizers, to help figure out how they can start changing.